The way I'm going to do this, we're going to ask you a couple of questions. I want to do this kind of Phil Donahue style, if you don't mind. I want to do something a little different, okay? So I'm going to ask a few questions, and I'm going to kind of let you guys ask a few questions. Is that okay? Are you up for this? It's only going to be as good as you guys are, okay? So we're going to go across as soon as they're all mic'd up. I'm going to let them introduce themselves because I don't have everybody's bio. I can tell you their names, but I don't have all their bios. So they're going to tell you who they are, what church they're with, and all that. One person I guess I will point out, like I said, is my hero being Kinchlow. I'm going to talk about him for a second. How many of you used to watch the 700 Club? You remember Ben from the 700 Club? I got saved when I was 16 years old. I gave my life to the Lord. I read one of those tracks called The New Birth. And after I got saved, I was trying to look for places to, you know, get some food. You know, I was supposed to really save. Because I remember running into my my parents had one of their friends over in the living room and they were talking, and I really didn't know anything except you need to be born again, right? So I went running into the living room. I asked the woman, I said, "Have you been saved?" And she looked back at me and she said, "Saved from what?" And I didn't know. I didn't know. I was so new, but I knew that what I had, I needed to share with somebody else. And so then I started watching the 700 Club. And I watched it because of Ben. I needed somebody who looked like me, though I'm not quite as tall as he is. I mean, I looked up to him then, but I shook his hand today. I'm like, "Hey, Ben." But I needed somebody who I could relate to. And I used to love him. I used to watch the 700 Club. I always turn it all the time. So I grew up on you, Mr. Kinchlow. And I'm so happy. I was so geeked when I found him on. You can clap for that. He's a good man. When I found him, again, he was writing for, is it Town Hall? Is your stuff?
World Night Deadly.
Yes. And I was reading his stuff, and I was thinking, I wonder if I can contact him, because I'd love to have his stuff on Freedom's Journal magazine, right? And so I checked on the email on there, and it was actually his email. I said, "Wow, let me email him." And I forgot, I think he ended up sending me, either send him my number and ask him to call me, or ask him for his number. Whatever happened, we ended up talking on the phone. And I was so geeked, because this is somebody who I looked up to for a number of years, who I'd kind of grown up on. So if I'm gushing with some pride and everything, it's because Ben Kinchlow, my hero's here. And he decided to come. And his op-eds are now on Freedom's Journal magazine, I must say. So anyway, now the rest of y'all can introduce yourself, because starting with my good friend Lance Davis, Bishop Lance Davis, excuse me, who actually was very, very instrumental in stopping same-sex marriage here in Illinois. You can clap for that. So go ahead, tell them a little bit more about yourself, and we'll just go right down the line.
Okay, my name is Lance Davis. I'm senior pastor of New Zion Covenant Church in Dalton, Illinois. I am the husband of my wife and high school sweetheart, Dr. Kira Davis. I'm here with my four wonderful children as well, Grace and Natalie and Lance and Andrew. I think this is important for them to see and to be a part of. I have been called from ministry or to ministry since I was 9 years old. I have spent the majority of my professional ministerial career in working in the area of liberating my people and speaking truth to power. And there are a lot of things that we've been engaged in as it relates to confronting either the body politic or those individuals who are wrongfully utilizing or using the African-American community for their ill-gotten gain. So many things that we've been involved in, but for the most part, I want to thank Dr. Wallace for the opportunity of being here as well as putting on this Black Conservative Summit. Thank you so much.
I'm Bishop David Allen Hall, the prelate of the Tennessee headquarters jurisdiction, the Church of God in Christ. I have served the Church of God in Christ for more than 30 years. I have, distinguished myself in many pursuits, socially, politically. I'm working currently with the Black farmers on their litigation against the USDA for discrimination. I'm involved in peace initiatives. Just recently, was working with a study group that was looking at policy for drone killings. I've studied the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, living with both Jews and Palestinians for a period of time. Done a few other things. I served the Church of God in Christ as a pastor there in Memphis, Tennessee as well. I'm also married to a doctor, a gastroenterologist named Mary. We married up.
And what's the name of that fraternity you say?
Oh, that fraternity. That great, see, you know, he's an alpha. Omega Psi Phi.
Alpha Phi Alpha. I'm sorry. That's
Cap was introduced first.
If you don't know, in the black community, we, you know, a lot of folks in other communities, it's, you know, fraternity is just when you're in college. For us, it continues on for the rest of our lives. So,
and we right and we, year, wrong color,
and we mess with each other every chance we get. So, Brother Kinchlow, something you want to say other than what I said?
I'm Ben Kinchlow, currently unemployed.
Doctor.
Dr. Glenn Pinckney, from Hickory, North Carolina. I pastored for many years, actually in the non-denominational persuasion, having grown up in the Church of God in Christ. But more recently, I've been engaged in a lot of Bible study teaching, or Bible teaching, I should say, and also formed an organization. The name of it is Christians Aligned for Actions and Principles, because I sincerely believe that Christians need to be engaged beyond the four walls of their churches, because our people need some help. And we need God in America again.
Dean.
My name is Dean Nelson. There we go, got it. As stated earlier, I serve as the chairman for the Frederick Douglass Foundation. I am actually a licensed Baptist minister originally. And I wear bow ties because I wasn't born in the Church of God in Christ. There was a man of God who wore bow ties before Louis Farrakhan, so I wanted to say that to Eric Wallace.
If you're going to say that, say Dr. Eric Wallace.
I also have, for about 15 years, served as a deputy director and then national director of what at the time was called New Generation Campus Ministries, which was the largest campus ministry outreaching to historically black colleges at that time. And since that time, I've served in a number of organizations, but am proudest to say that I'm the husband of one wife and blessed with three beautiful children.
Amen.
Good evening again. My name is Ceasar LeFlore, associate pastor at New Community Church, also in Dolton, Illinois, right down the road from my good friend Bishop Lance Davis, who is one of my heroes in the ministry. Also, I'm the executive director of our nonprofit, The Beloved Community, which actually started from a vision Bishop Davis and I shared together when we used to meet and pray with our former mayor. And so I'm the chairman of that nonprofit coalition, and I'm also working with LEARN, the Life Education and Resource Network. I am the Midwest Regional Director, responsible for organizing 11 states here in the Midwest.
I'm Wayne Perryman from Seattle, Washington. You heard my introduction earlier today, so I won't say any further now.
Oh, that's just because you got a Ken Griffey shirt on. That's my friend Wayne Perryman. We've known each other for quite some time. I started the African American Republican Council a number of years ago. And he was our first speaker to come out. That's when we first met each other. When was that, 2000-something? Anyway, it was a long time ago, a number of years ago, at least 8 years ago, something like that. And we've been good friends ever since. You know, sometimes when you meet a person for the first time, it just all of a sudden just clicks. It's like you've known them for years. Well, with most of these people, I feel that way about when I first met them. It's like, okay, this is somebody who's a true brother, if you will, in the Lord. Okay, now it's time to get down to business. I see Ben's taking notes already. Let me do my Phil Donahue pose. Now. I'm sorry, I want to have a little fun with this. Is that okay? Is that okay? Can we have a little fun? I know it's late. So we got these pastors up on the stage. And see if you can recognize this quote. Well, what is the title of our talk? The State of the Black Church. and its effect on the black family. Since we're talking about black family, and since we all believe that church plays a big role in this, tell me what you think is the, I'll give the big general, and then we'll go down to specifics. Generally speaking, what do you think the state is of the black church? Don't all jump out at once. Just
I think anyone. The biggest problem, at least in my experience in South Carolina, North Carolina, and Missouri, the biggest problem is the lack of teaching so that our people truly understand what it really means to be a Christian, to be a disciple of Christ. We've got church down. We know how to be religious, but we really need to learn what it means to be a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ.
Now you're Dr. Pinckney, what's that? Is that an MD, is that a PhD, is that a DMAN?
No, that's theology, I mean, so don't get sick, but I can pray for you if you do get sick. Yes, sir, I can definitely lay hands on you. I could do that even in the Church of God in Christ before my doctorate, so.
So you speak from an educated point of view. Go ahead, Bishop.
I look at the situation with the black church. What I've said to the jurisdiction that I serve, and that's some 52 churches, that we want to recommit ourselves to placing the church back on the ground. I think that there is a disconnect now, that the social trappings, the ceremony, and all the things that church happened to be, it is received and rejected all at the same time, and has lost, I think, a real significance in the mindset of the larger community. So we've got to make the reconnect, just as Jesus put his people out two by two to go heal the sick, to preach, to teach, and put them on in the street without script, without this and that. He said, go serve. I think that's where the church needs to get back to the street, with witness and action.
Well, doesn't the more progressive churches, aren't they in the street? Aren't they trying to feed people?
We all do, and we all continue to do so. But what is the real connect when you see the escalating numbers in drug addiction, out of wedlock births, miseducation? There's a disconnect.
Anybody else?
I'd like to pick up on just a little bit of what he said about the fact that I think, if, with all due respect, one of the things that the worst thing could happen to the church is we got religious. The Bible is not a religious book.
Amen.
The church is not supposed to be a religious organization. He said, go out and be salt and light, not religion. In fact, if you look at the Bible objectively, what you'll find is 7 references to religion or religious. 7 references. Of those 7 references, 6 of them are, let's just say, less than positive.
That's right.
Now, if somebody said something about something you were doing, and they made 7 comments about them, and 6 of them were less than positive, that wouldn't that give you pause? Well, I think that's part of the problem that has happened with us in our church, particularly in African-American church. I grew up going to church. I mean, I didn't go to church because I wanted to. I went to church because Mama was bigger than me. There was 2 things that we never did in my house, and both of them was arguing with Mama. But we went to church, and I was in church every Sunday, and I sat right up on the front row, right 2 people over from Ms. Kelly. All y'all had a Ms. Kelly in your church. Ms. Kelly had a walking cane, and every time when them kids would get out of line, because you weren't supposed to have no fun at all in church, except for the sisters who got happy every now and then. But the rest of us, no fun. So I went to church until I got big enough to argue with Mama, and I stopped going to church. Because church didn't have nothing to do with real life. And I think that's one of the problems that we're facing now. And I think that's one of the problems that our young people are dealing with now. They said, this don't have to do with real life. And so they're just drifting away from it.
I'm going to come back to you with another question in a minute as to why you went to another organization. You became a black Muslim, right? Okay. Don't talk about it right now. Not yet. Go ahead.
If I can just say one thing to add on to that, not to sound redundant, but I think one of the problems that happened not only to the black church but to the church in general is that we became more interested in advancing the church as opposed to advancing the kingdom of God. The church became a thing into itself, and so everything that we started doing was to proliferate the church, to grow the church, to advance the church, and we didn't look at our mission of advancing the kingdom of God. In the Bible, Jesus only mentions the church one time, but he talks about the coming and advancing of his kingdom over 100 times. So it wasn't to advance the organism, the organization, it was to advance the organism, which is the living body of Christ. And we've lost sight of that, and we've got caught up in the organizational structures, which leads us to compromise on a lot of levels. You know, it leads us to make alliances that maybe we shouldn't. It leads us to go down some roads that maybe we shouldn't do so that we can keep our organizations up and going, and we lose sight of our primary objective. That is to advance the kingdom of God. So I think the organization, the organized church, became our biggest problem.
Amen. Can I ask you a question on that?
Yes, sir.
When you hear the word kingdom of God, you could ask a lot of people, but what does that mean?
Okay, well, that's a good question. The kingdom of God, well, I look at it this way. A kingdom, what is a kingdom? It's someone who has a king. You know, and so any ways that Jesus is Lord, that's where the kingdom of God is. And if there's a king, then there's a domain. And so any way that where he is Lord becomes the kingdom of God. This room right now could become the kingdom of God. If people in here would agree that Jesus is Lord, and then we determine that this would become his domain, and we would live according to the principles that he lays out for us, then that becomes the kingdom of God. Jesus said when he came, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. It's not something that we're waiting to see when we die and get on the other side. The kingdom of God is present right here and right now. It's where he is Lord, and we advance that, and we teach people to live according to the principles of the king. The king says it, therefore we do it, and that becomes the kingdom.
Bishop Davis.
Yeah, and so in follow-up to that statement, since we have not created the kingdom of God, since we have been disobedient, since we have been a people who dismiss, the word of God, we dismiss going to church, the value of church. Now your question was, what's the state of the black church? Irrelevant. What's the state of the black church? Silent. What's the state of the black church? Back of the bus. What's the state of the black church? So we have to be honest with ourselves. What's the state of the black church? Everyone coming in looking for something, as we do to the government, looking for something to give nothing. Therefore, with the rising cost of everything, and yet people want to utilize the church as a means to get food, as a place to get counseling and all these things, the church has become irrelevant because she doesn't even listen to her children anymore. The church has become irrelevant because it doesn't listen to the heart of the poor anymore. The church became an institution where we just try and build the biggest buildings and fly planes, and we do a lot of things with money, but we don't do anything as it relates to the propagation or the continuum of the call of God. And so now we are dealing with a curse, and we are dealing with a sociological reality where our children are killing each other, where our daughters have no virtue, no degree or understanding of modesty whatsoever. And now it's time for us to accept that, ask for God's forgiveness for walking away from his statutes and his precepts, and then figure out what we need to do to go on from here.
Did you want to say something?
Yeah, first of all, I agree with most of the members here of the panel, but I also want to say that I commend the black church for ministering to millions of people every week, that if those churches weren't there, our society would be far worse than it is today. I have seen black preachers preach the word of God, and the members do not respond. Jesus said, "Why call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things I say?" They weren't even responsive to Jesus. So the conditions in our society is not necessarily the reflection that preachers are not preaching or giving the word. It is whether the people are responding to the word that's being preached. Now, all of us in the pastoral ranks, we know we wouldn't have the counseling problems if some of the folks would just be doers of the word and not hearers only. So it's not like the preachers have failed. I think, in my estimation, the biggest problem that we have with the black church is division. Scripture said a house divided against itself cannot stand. If the black churches, the black clergy came together in America, it would be the most powerful force in this country. And Satan knows that, so he'll find different reasons to keep us apart. You're Baptist, you're Kojic, you're Pentecostal, you're not this, you're AME. And as long as Satan can keep that division, he could keep us divided, and there's no power in that division. So I think the state of the black church, if we can ever unite, then we would be a powerful force, because I think the vast majority of the churches, as I travel around the country and preach and hear them preach, they're preaching against sin. And the question of it is, if we could all come together collectively, like the pastors and bishops here in Chicago, to stand against same-sex marriage like Bishop Blake and some of the others did in LA, that just shows the unity and the power of the church when they come together. And I think that's the biggest problem that we have today.
Dean, did you want to say something before we?
Yeah, I think for me, there are a lot of ways to look at it. I don't disagree with much has been said. But for me, the real challenge that I see in the black church, if we could use that term, is what I would think of as almost kind of a modern day syncretism. I mean, we've got a lot of mixture within the black church. There are some good things, and then there's a lot of things that shouldn't be there. And I think that often I've recognized that the black church, particularly with an example that I saw in Washington, D.C., is content with doing church while we allow the government in some regards to encroach in doing things that the church should be doing. And I think that we've been content. In Washington, D.C. 3 years ago, when there was the whole challenge of same-sex marriage, it took someone like Bishop Harry Jackson to come from Maryland into Washington, D.C., because there were so many churches that did not want to speak up with a prophetic voice because they were concerned with the block grants that they might not get in speaking out against what was going on in their city. So I feel like that we have we've lost power and authority. That quote that I mentioned earlier with, you know, Dr. King, I mean, he said that we would become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority if we lost that prophetic zeal. And I think that we have lost that. We've settled for something other than what we've talked about within the kingdom. And, you know, at this stage of the game, we're kind of content with that, I believe, in much of the black church.
I'm surprised. You kind of touched on it a second. I see you, Ben. You look up in the air. I know your mind is just racing. But you touched on something that I'm surprised nobody, you didn't challenge beyond. I mean, how do we define the black church?
Right.
What is it? And is that the right terminology we should be using?
Yeah, that was my question. Why do we have a black church? Why do we have a white church?
But the segregation is there. It's clear.
Not anymore.
It's breaking down, but for the most part, that statement that Sunday morning is the most segregated period and time of this country's throughout the entire week of the country. I think it's more important that we take our position, we take our community, we take our families, and we put them on a level of value just like anyone else's family, just like anyone else's community. And we begin to do a comparative analysis to determine exactly where we are. Are we educating our children? Are we keeping our streets and our communities safe? And if we're not doing that, I think the prophetic voice of the community of the believers, which we're calling the black church, has to come together and address that and redress that issue.
Okay, go ahead. I'm going to let you address it. Then I have another question.
There is a black church, and there is a church organizationally and collegially. We all share in some institution that is church, and the titular responsibility, the control of property, money, influence, and all of those things are factors that factor into where people are and how they operate, plus along with, of course, the theological doctrines and tenets that drive the engine there. But does there have to be a wall of separation because of those institutionalized and organizational situations that are relative to the structure? by no means. We all here believe in Christ, his power, and prophetic witness that comes and emanates from our structures daily. We believe in it, and I don't doubt the capacity of any of you all to do an effective job. Again, I say that there's a loss of connection with the people that we're addressing, and that, to me, I think we need to get back to.
Is there more than one black church?
Yeah.
Because you have those of us who believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and that the Bible has something to say, the Bible is the Word of God. There are others out there who don't necessarily believe that and will preach civil rights and politics, prosperity. Well, that's another group.
That's right.
So you've got one group preaching prosperity, you can be rich, you just have enough faith. There's another group that talks about how we just need to march for our rights and are talking about civil rights part of the civil rights movement and seem to be stuck there. And then there's another group that talks about the Bible and the Word of God and sometimes don't even deal with civil rights at all. And then there's what I think, so I'm making at least four categories here, and you can agree with me or disagree, I'm throwing it out here, that is more holistic and sees the church involved in every area of life, and some would call them the seven mountains, if you will. I don't know if you want to limit it to seven, but people have mentioned the seven mountains of influence, and they understand that Christians should be involved in every area of our life, not just to come to church on Sunday, hear a good message, and go home. Do you agree with maybe those four different descriptions, if you will, or would you say that there may be even more, but maybe the four basic descriptions of the church? I see you smiling, so I don't know if you want to jump right in on this or not, Bishop Davis.
No,
you're not. You're not going to touch it. Okay.
I'm gonna give someone else.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, I think the scripture is very clear. Paul said, to the Jews, I became a Jew. To the Greek, I became a Greek. Churches, and I think the Holy Spirit uses cultures to reach different cultures. And it's not necessarily Satan is involved in all the different cultures. Paul, you know, he wrote to the church in Corinth. He wrote to the various churches in Asia Minor. And I think he wrote to them many times because of the culture that they were accustomed to and the things that they were going through. So I don't see the different churches being a problem situation. I see it as God's unique ability to reach all cultures, regardless of how they worship. Korean church may not worship like the black church. The traditional Lutheran church may not worship like the Methodist church. But I think the Lord uses the different cultures in order to reach cultures that the others could not reach. Paul reached people that Peter did not even reach out to. But Paul was a man who was accustomed to the different cultures. So when you talk about the black church, I don't see so much of the division in the way that they preach Christ or in the way that they worship. I see more of it in a way of reaching different people who have different cultural backgrounds.
Well, I'm not necessarily talking about the way people worship. I'm talking about the way people even see the text and what the role of the church is. What I'm getting at, what is the role of the church?
I was going to say, I think this illustrates our problem. You know, I think because of what the church has become, that's why we see all these divisions. You know, the Lord only came to establish one church. That's the church of Jesus Christ. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. There's not supposed to be any separation between us. We might, you know, go to different congregations, we might live in different communities, but we're all part of one body. And so we have to look at that. We're part of the church of Jesus Christ. And either you are a Christian, either you are a believer, or you're not. If your doctrine then violates the sanctity of the scriptures that we follow, well, then you might call yourself a church, but you're not. You're not. So I think there's only one church. We are living stones, fitly joined together. We are unified behind this one Lord. Now, we might come from different perspectives in life, and I'm okay with that as long as we're following the one gospel of Jesus Christ. And so I think that becomes a problem. I think because we have become so loyal to our own organizations, that we've started separating ourselves around our own doctrine. And then once we start doing that, then we stop being followers of Jesus Christ. We become followers of whoever the man is who's laying out the plan. And so Jesus came to be our example. He's our Lord. That's who we follow. And if we're not doing that, then we're missing the boat.
Our Christian walk requires that we unify and we come together. And you're right. It's supposed to be one church, which means that if one believer is hurting, then all believers are hurting. Unfortunately, when you start talking about the black church versus the white church or the Asian church, there's an 800-pound gorilla in the room. There's a group of folk who are in a church, whatever it is, who are overwhelmingly in a depressed situation, mm-hmm. a challenged situation, economically, psychologically, emotionally, socially, however you want to look at it. And yet the rest of the body seems not to care. And therein lies the issue. And therein lies the separation. We have to answer that question. I think we can exchange niceties and talk about the state of the black church, and we can be very flowery about it. But the truth of the matter is we've got an issue in this country. And that as the black church suffers and as our children have to deal with images of themselves, the Miley Cyruses of our community have been out there for 12 years, and yet no one, including the church, has said anything about black women twerking. But then the moment that a white young lady who influences millions of white girls comes and does the same things that our young children have been portrayed as doing for over a decade and a half, for us to sit as a church and say absolutely nothing for a decade and a half about the way the world perceives our children, that tells me that there are separate churches out here, because the whole church should have come to the defense of all black children who have to look at images of themselves like that.
We're going to go down, because I know I see on Ben's face he wants
no,
to say something.
I'm just listening.
Okay.
I think that we need to address what the Bible has demonstrated. From the inception of the church, there's always been a desire to put the right people in the right area to serve at the right time. What Paul did, Peter could never have done because of his bias, his upbringing, even though the liberating power of the Spirit through a vision told him everything was okay now. It's all good, man. Eat it, swallow it. But he couldn't do it. So then God rose up and looked down the road and saw this guy and put him down on the ground and changed him from Saul to Paul. And in the 12th chapter of Acts, it said that the church was assembled and they were fasting and praying. And the Spirit said, pick me out. And he picked out Barnabas and he picked out Saul. And then they fasted and prayed a while. And then they laid their hands on him and said, now you go out there and you do this thing. And he left those guys in Jerusalem, and Barnabas and Paul went out to the world where those guys in Jerusalem would not go. So you see, so there's always been, if you would, an appropriateness, the right person for the right thing. And God has a lot of us to speak a lot of ways about the one God.
You know, can I ask the kind of a question from in the past? Like,
okay, Elder.
I grew up in church. I went to the African Methodist Episcopal Church on the first and third Sundays. I went to the Baptist Church on the second and fourth Sunday. And on the fifth Sunday, we drove over to a place called Crystal City, where the Pentecostal Holiness Church. Then when I graduated from the eighth grade and went off to high school, I went to a Catholic church. So I've been around the horn, so to speak. I got to the point where I was so disillusioned by all of this that I started studying to become a black Muslim, because I liked what Malcolm X was talking about, and I thought that this was the way to resolve the problem for the black community. I got to the point where I actually hated white people, and then I started hating brown people that thought they was white, and then I started hating black people that didn't think like I thought. And then one day, I was driving around in a car at 80 miles an hour. My wife
and I had gotten a divorce just about. We were separated. We were living in different places. My kids were all paranoid, and my dad and mom thought I was crazy. And I was deciding what I was going to do, and I thought, you know, somebody's going to take me out, or I'm going to take somebody out. And all of a sudden, pardon me, but I had this encounter with the living God. He changed my life. Instantly, I was colorblind. I had no concept any longer of white and black. It was only right and wrong. Yes, some people shouted and threw their hands up in the air, and others sat with their arms crossed and folded, but they were still worshiping the same God through Jesus Christ. So if we say we are his disciples and that he lives in us, from whence cometh the separation? Why are we sitting here talking about the black church instead of the church of Jesus Christ? Is there really a separation in the body of Christ? There's neither Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free. We're all one. Am I somewhere off the track here? Somebody help me.
Actually, my friend, that therein lies the problem, which is why I stated initially the problem with the church is that our people are not being taught scripturally. Because when we come to understand scripture, and when we come to understand who Jesus Christ really is, and when we come to understand that God himself had every single one of us to be born for a divine purpose, and when we come to accept him as Lord and Savior, then we move beyond race, we move beyond denomination, because we are brothers and sisters spiritually. But as long as we continue to look at this stuff secularly, as long as we continue to look at the church, the black church, the white church, the denominations, then we are operating in the flesh and not in the spirit, and then our congregants operate in the flesh, not in the spirit, and we continue to live in the same turmoil, which is why we're losing 75 churches a week in this country. Because people are, you know, I said I do a lot of teaching. I can't tell you the number of people, and I'm not about to do this, but the number of people that come to me and say, man, I just really want to be taught what it means to be a Christian. We're missing the point. We're getting off into all of these nice, funny, fancy things, which has nothing to do with the spirit. And until we get back to that part, from the pulpit to the door, until we get back there, we are still going to have these divisions, and we're going to still have these problems, and our people are going to still suffer, and the vast majority of our sufferings are manifested from the spiritual realm, because the word says it, my people perish for lack of knowledge. And he's not talking about academia. He's not talking about academia. You ask the average Christian in the, you ask the average church member in the average church, what does it really mean to be born again?
Exactly.
I promise you, they cannot give you an accurate answer, and I don't care what denomination it is. Because we're not teaching our people the word of God for their spiritual growth so that they can become who God wants them to be.
You must be born again. You're absolutely right, brother.
We can do all this other conversation. It's like the little brother said on the tape during lunch. He said, I listened to all these people at the UN do all this talking, but all they need to do is just do the right thing.
And that's be born again.
Amen.
So is there a pseudo church?
Oh yeah.
Oh no. Look, we can go through all that, but that there are believers in Jesus Christ, and then there are religious people. That's the bottom line.
Well, let me at least say this. I mean, while I agree with that, I do want to say that the church is born. It's made up of people who are messed up. that are coming into the knowledge of Christ, there's a sanctification process.
Yes.
So there are some instances where people are hit great encounters with God, and you know, they give up drugs or they give up, you know, whatever. But I think that it's important for us to think that there is not a perfect church. So people are growing in this process in their understanding. I've been a minister for 20 years now. There are things that I'm growing in, that I'm learning, that there's new teaching, there's things that I'm processing. So I do understand that we can become frustrated sometimes with, you know, these segments and divisions, but there were divisions within the first church. And so my hope is that we're all pointing people to Christ and being patient with them as they're growing and developing, and as we're growing and developing, teaching until that great day.
And we want them to have that desire to grow. That's the key. They have to make that connection.
Dr. Wallace, real quick, wasn't this in context of the Black Conservative Summit addressing the problems of the inner city and some of the issues that are facing African Americans? Because if it is, and we talked about abortion, we talked about same-sex marriage, we talked about some of these issues, and I see as many white churches standing on the sideline as I do Black churches. So to be able to point out just a Black church, how many white churches are crying when kids are dying in Chicago? How many white pastors around the country have tears? When those kids were shot in Connecticut and I watched on TV, tears came down my eyes. But when I hear how many kids are shot in Chicago, I don't see white pastors with tears in their eyes. So it's a two-way street. It's not just the Black churches not doing anything. If you look at the white churches, Korean churches, and the others, they're not Latino churches. They're not standing behind some of the pastors that are out there in the forefront. I know for a fact that Bishop Joseph Matta of New York, he said there were 10,000 churches that sat on the sidelines while he and 2,000 churches fought against same-sex marriage in New York. And he said, Dr. Perryman, it was as many white churches as Black churches that stood on the sideline to watch us fight.
I want to thank all of you pastors for sharing with us tonight. I have actually more of a comment that may go into a question. I'm the proud wife of Bishop Lance Davis, and I've, in that capacity, I've been a first lady for over two decades. And it's interesting, we opened this discussion talking about alphas and kappas and omegas. And those of us in sororities and fraternities know that when we meet, that there are certain criteria for getting in the meeting. And a Kappa can't come into an Alpha meeting, and an AKA can't come into our meeting. But in the church, where that criteria for meeting should be the blood of Jesus buying us from our sin debt, is often not there. Yet we let the unsaved in, where when I read the Bible, it seems that the evangelists should do the preaching on the outside, and when there's a conversion, they come into our church, because the church should be made up of believers. Now, I don't know about other pastors or church members in here, but we got a whole lot of people coming through our doors in Dalton who are not there as believers, but are there to meet their own need for whatever agenda item they have. So it's no mystery why we have a Black church, white church. It's no mystery why we have no power. It's no mystery why we aren't crying for it, because the church is it really church? And that's my question to you.
Well, the Bible says the church is his body. That's, and the body is composed of a lot of different parts. We all agree that the body is composed of a lot of different parts. I mean,
but the church, the Bible also says, what fellowship has light to do with darkness?
That's true, but we're talking about,
and if darkness is entering our doors and singing in our choirs and even teaching in our pulpits.
Now you're getting to my point, because teaching
for the body of Christ to understand the value of Christianity, the value of being a born-again believer, you wouldn't have the unsaved in your choir. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't have the unsaved in your pulpit. But we do, because it has become an organization and a traditional, it's a Sunday country club for a lot of people, as opposed to teaching the truth of the Word of God so that people can have a rebirth experience into the body of Christ.
Oh, wait a minute, wait a minute.
This is your wife, right? Okay.
One last time, okay?
How is it then that secular organizations like the sororities and fraternities are so effective at keeping themselves pure when we, with the power of the Holy Spirit, can let darkness infiltrate?
The same way that we allowed prayer to be taken out of school.
But if darkness had not infiltrated the church, that wouldn't have happened.
Because we don't stand. And it's because we have become anemic is why we don't stand.
I love this panel. I really do. And I think, Pastor, that you're hitting on the very mark of the problem within our church, and that's teaching and education.
Amen.
Which is a foundation for all things. Because the Bible clearly states that we're supposed to go out and teach all nations, but if we're illiterate, how can we do a good job of that?
Absolutely.
But this is a query to me. Each of you has been a member of a seminary, a student in a seminary at some time in your life. Do you, it's a question. Here's a question. Did you all go to seminary first? Let me just get that clarification.
Yeah, I would say that I never graduated from seminary.
Okay.
Yeah, but I have.
Now that we have the clarification on the table, that some of you may have, perchance, have gone to a seminary. Is there a problem in the seminary, the seed, in which many other pastors are bred, especially at Howard University, Chrislam, homosexuality, and things of that particular nature that are being now then degreed and then preached? And then secondly, why are there so few churches, as mega church as many as that are, out of education in the first place? Why are there no Baptist schools? Why are there no AME schools for education at the elementary, high school, junior high school level?
I just want to be the first to sort of jump on that. If we're going to continue to talk about the black church more specifically, there is a movement of anti-intellectualism in the black community anyway. Therefore, whatever is within the community has now bled into the church, which is what my wife so eloquently was talking about, how it is that you can't tell the difference between the church and a secular organization other than the fact that the secular organization knows who's a member and the other has a problem trying to figure out who should be a member. But again, that whole movement of anti-intellectualism has bred the movement of, I was moved by the Holy Ghost to lead these people, and unfortunately, it breeds an environment of more of the same, not knowing the word, not understanding the context for the Christian message, and all these other things. So I think that we are overwhelmed with a mediumistic movement to remove intellectualism from our community, and that's the reason why we can stay with the political agenda that kills our kids and destroys our communities and create black people who depend on the government to take care of their basic needs and then depend upon them to fight for their rights. That's the reason why we have what we have. And so we are indeed in a intellectual deficit within our community, and we need to address that.
I would like to speak to part of that as well. You asked the question about, you know, the Christian education. Why are there no, you know, Baptist schools or, you know, AME schools? I think part of that problem is what we were talking about earlier, is where we have kind of settled and said and accepted that, well, you know, there are government schools that are going to do that, and that's not my responsibility. But if we go back to what he was saying, teaching, I mean, we have a responsibility. It is our responsibility to instruct ours. I've chosen to homeschool at great sacrifice. Why? It's my responsibility. It's not the government's responsibility. It's my responsibility. If you look in the scriptures, it encourages you know, the parents to be the what? The educators of their children. And if we want to be able to do that in a Christian context, for a parent to have the right or the authority to give that over to someone else, then God holds us accountable for that. But I think that we have to answer this fundamental question regarding the next generation, and that is, whose responsibility is it? And is it not worth the sacrifice? I mean, if we're talking about our children, aren't our children worth it for us to say, well, I'm going to sacrifice to do what it takes to impart? We have this saying in our house that is our responsibility to, as the Bible says, that foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, right? It is our responsibility to displace that foolishness with biblical wisdom. Whose responsibility is that? That is our responsibility as parents, as ministers, as teachers to do that. And I think that that's one of the reasons that we don't see more Christian education within the black community, because we've given it over to, you know, the public schools or the government, and we're not really engaged in that arena.
Well, I would say that...
To just to jump on that point as well...
Are you cutting me off again, Ben?
Excuse me?
Are you cutting me off again?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't,
no, go ahead.
I didn't.
Go ahead. But they're my hero.
Point,
you can do
almost
that.
Almost all of the major school systems were run by the churches, by the Christians. Mm-hmm. You know, you take Harvard, Yale, Princeton, and all these other... They were all essentially Christian schools. Right. All of Western civilization is based on the Judeo-Christian principles. And if you go to places where the Judeo-Christian principles are not extant, then you see things like you see happening in places like China and India and the Middle East and places like that, because they don't believe in the Judeo-Christian principles that make up our society. The problem is the church began to pull out of society, and we left it over, and nature abhors a vacuum. So if you pull out of something, nature's going to suck something in there. So now we have people in church, and we have a lot, not in church, but in these systems, that we allow to be in there when even America was based on Christian principles that we, the church, the people, the Christians, were expected to show people how to operate. You know, and that's the way it's supposed to happen. But unfortunately, we pulled out of society. We pulled out and started being, as somebody said, we're so heavenly minded, we're no earthly good anymore. But we pulled out, and that's what happened. They took over when we pulled out. If you want it back, then what you have to do is you have to do what they did. You have to go back and take it back. And that's the only way that we can change that.
Go ahead, Bishop Hall.
I think this points up to the fact that now the church is dealing with the clash of cultures. To be church, to not be to be churched. You know, how does the church interact with the weight of where society is now moving? And I see that it is moving now against the church. And I see that the church is in a posture of reactionary posture to what's going on. So fundamentally, there is an educational problem. There's even a logistical problem, and it's all undergirded with the lack of opportunity, education, finances, privilege, everything. And so you got a mess in the foundational elements. And what does the church teach? How can the church not react but become proactive now against this society that is encroaching? And you're starting to see less and less difference between church and society. And that's beginning a real problem. What did Jesus do? And I'll bring it to close. They said, is it right for you to pay your taxes? Jesus said, well, you know, he's not going to fight the society. He knows that if he says one thing, he's going to be really in trouble. He says, bring me a coin. He says, whose superscription and image is on it? And he said, Caesar. He said, okay, then you render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and the things that are God's, you give them to God. Now the church is at a point now, rather than reacting, we need to start acting on the things that God have given us. Start doing those, and doing those without excuse, without hesitation. And whether we seem to be, you know, missing the boat or ridiculed for it, if it's going to take homeschooling, then you homeschool them. If it's going to take making a substantial difference between who's singing in your choir and who's not singing in your choir, then you do what you got to do. But the church has got to be the church and give God what's his. And then also, we'll have to deal with the world as we encounter it. But we got to know who we are and do what we do.
To speak to his question,
amen,
about the seminaries, because that was a part of your question. There is a lot of, put it this way, suspect and non-biblical instructions, or perhaps I should even say instructors. I remember a friend of mine not too long ago sharing that his instructor mentioned that her partner, her life partner, was waiting for her in the car. And this was a seminary instructor. So again, we have stopped being light. Our salt is no longer salty. And as Ben said, you know, the vacuum, it's a spiritual war. The enemy does not take a break. He does not slow down. If we don't stand, he is going to roll over us. And that's so the seminaries, not all of them, of course, and I know you understand that, but there are issues within the seminaries, within some of the seminaries.
Amen. My name is Apostle David Rogers. I'm the senior leader of the House of Prayer for All Nations Ministries. I want to do this real quick. I want to address the issue that Pastor Davis brought up about membership. Anytime you talk about race and church, you have to talk about responsibility. It's just not a racial thing. It's a responsibility thing. And as my wife and I travel around the country, what we're finding out about churches is nobody wants to take the responsibility to properly structure a discipleship program so that people can be developed.
That's right.
So we go to churches, there's gatherings, there's conferences, there's workshops. But the day-to-day structure for discipleship is non-existent.
Exactly.
And who's responsible for that? Well, the person that's responsible for that is us as senior leaders. We have to do a better job at training and developing leadership teams that can function to disciple and have relationships with people in our churches, because we're trying to change the climate of cities when our churches have embraced the same culture of the city. We cannot do the same thing they do and then bring them into conversion. Our churches have to become more structured, more systematic, and more focused on developing disciples, not building big churches, not having workshops, not driving fancy cars. And we need to hold somebody accountable for it, and that starts with our senior leaders.
Amen.
That's where we need to begin.
Amen.
Dr. Wallace, there's two different types of teaching that we're talking about here, teaching within the church and a teaching outside the church. Now, my friend has a child daycare center, and he's licensed by the state of Washington, and they're requiring him to tell the preschool kids in his preschool that two mommies and two daddies are okay. And so when you look at the teaching situation, yeah, we have a teaching situation in the church. Jesus had a problem. He chose 12 in his church, and one denied him, another betrayed him, but he was a good teacher. But the other element of it is that we, the church, are paying billions of dollars in taxes for them to teach our children against things that we're teaching in the church. And the church is not speaking that against that school system that's telling them it's okay to have two mommies, it's okay to love someone of the same sex, and they're using our dollars under the separation of church and state to indoctrinate our kids in simple principles, and we're not speaking out against those things.
Well, a very simple answer to that. That's a really very simple answer to that. The reason that happened is because we, the church, has pulled itself out of that. The reason we have people serving in Congress, the people we have serving, because they are not Christians, because we, the pastors and leaders,
pulled our people out of the world and let the world take over. That's not the way it should be. We should be salt and light making these decisions.
Well, what does that mean? What is the role of the church?
He said we were salt and light. That means that the people who are making laws should be people who had know what the law is. Christians should be in the political arena.
Amen.
And we should not fear,
but do you think
501c3 that we fear so severely. What we need to do is educate ourselves about the laws so that we understand that the 501c3 designation, which we must have so that we don't pay taxes, which I said before, I really think all churches should just relinquish their 501c3, pay the taxes, and stand up for God.
Amen, amen.
Well, people
I have to ask.
Anyway.
They do. Exactly. I have to ask this question because part of our issue, at least in my opinion, in the African American community, is that we've allowed the liberal agenda to change. And some of you already addressed part of this. Is that that culture, secular culture, has come into the church, and we've allowed the government now to be the sustainer of people as opposed to the church. And I'm so tired of hearing people. I know Jesse Jackson Jr. used to do this all the time. Yes, I'm saying his name. And probably senior as well. Well, they'll come out and they'll quote, you know, we need to take care of the least of these. And they use that to say we need more government programs.
Exactly.
And I argue that, wait a minute, Jesus wasn't speaking to Caesar.
Amen.
And I don't mean Ceasar LeFlore. I mean Tiberius Caesar. I mean...
Jesus ain't talking to me.
He wasn't talking about you. He wasn't saying we need to get the government. We need to pay more taxes so the government can give some more handouts. I think he was speaking to the church, and that it was the church that was supposed to take care of the needy, to go visit people in the prisons, and that transformation came. Sorry, I'm gonna start to preach now for a second. So give me a minute. Transformation comes when people who have needs meet people in the church who have been transformed and can help meet those needs. The people who help meet those needs become better disciples because they're doing God's work and God's working through them. The people who have the need come in contact with people who are filled with the Holy Spirit and then get challenged to have their lives changed. That doesn't happen when government gives you a check.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't happen when they give you food stamps, right? I'm preaching, please give me some. So we abdicate that stuff, and we abdicate education. We abdicate, you know, giving people clothing and housing. I argue in the RISE principles that it's the only place where people find real transformation is when the church stands up to be the church and starts to take over some of these things. And I've had people actually argue with me and say, "Well, the church is too small. We don't have that many members in our church." And I say, where have you been? Have you been in this? Have people been preaching all this time and you're not listening? Do you not see that Jesus took the two fish and five loaves of bread and fed thousands? We don't see these. I'm sorry.
But Dr. Wallace.
We don't see these miracles because we don't allow God to take what little bit we have.
That's right.
Give it to him and say, Lord, we have great need. Can you bless this and multiply it? And watch God create a miracle.
But the system.
Dr. Wallace, but you would have system. To teach. You've got a church of six members. You would have to teach your six members the value of the Word of God and a relationship with God so that when one more person comes in from the outside, those six members know how to transfer the love of God to them to show them what it means to be born again.
Amen.
What it means to be a Christian and how God can provide for them through faith. But your six members can't do that if they haven't been taught. If they don't have
they get discipled by whoever the leader
exactly.
is.
Exactly. There
it
you
goes
go.
Back to what he said.
You
about
and your six members, yeah. You're supposed to disciple them so they
I
can disciple others.
Now. Go ahead.
But if your six members are all Democrats.
But see, even if they are, and you teach them the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
See, the Word of God transcends the D and the R and the and the I.
That's true.
Amen.
But what I'm saying is if they're Democrats, they are not going to look at the state constitution, Article 10, that says It is the state's primary responsibility to provide a high-quality education for all of its students. So we are focused on education, and as a matter of fact, we're protected by the state constitution as it relates to education. But then we are looking at, yes, we need to make disciples, we need to deepen their walk with the Lord, but we have this other social justice issue that is just as pressing. And sometimes what we're trying to do is to figure out, well, you know, are we going to be the church, the black church, and all these other kind of questions, when in fact there's some basic social justice issues that need to be confronted, whether you're white or black. And what happens is, because Jesse Jr. and others have done nothing but said, lay on your back, collect the check, get something because the government owes you something, we have a responsibility to say, that's a categorical lie.
Amen.
Not to let him be a congressman for 17 years.
Amen.
And never pull him, you know, the carpet from
Amen.
Under him, or hold him accountable for
Amen.
What he's saying.
Amen.
And that's been our issue. It's been the silence.
And if we teach our people the word of God, we will invariably teach them that your reliance and your dependence should not be on the government, but on God.
Yes.
And as you grow in faith, you will begin to see how God will work miracles in your life to provide provisions, whether it be to go back to school, to start your own business. God will give you the wisdom. This is what the body of Christ needs to understand. Our hope is in God. But since we don't teach them that, the only God they have is Barack and Company.
That's right.
But there's a place that you start. He said something earlier during this little testimony. He said when he got saved,
mm-hmm.
I know exactly what he's talking about because I did exactly the same thing. When you get born again,
Amen.
The first thing you want to do is tell somebody
right.
that this is the most important thing that ever happened in my life.
Exactly.
Then it's our responsibility as teachers to teach them how to go do this. Because this is why Jesus brought these people. He brought them in and he said, now, I'm going to send you out to do this. Some he made apostles, others he made prophets, evangelists,
Amen.
Pastors,
Amen.
And teachers for Amen. Not to do the big churches and the big cars, but for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry.
That's right.
That's who's supposed to be doing
Amen.
The job, not us, them.
Amen.
But they don't know what they're supposed to do because we haven't told them.
Because we don't teach them.
Exactly. And so, a lot of them weren't born again either.
So we come right back to the very fundamental issue.
You got to be born again.
You got to be born again. And then after being born again, you have to be discipled.
Yeah. I would. My name is Frank Cristiano, and Pastor Ben, I too am unemployed. I'd like to ask the panel generally, why aren't we fighting for school vouchers if you want to control education in our communities?
I think school vouchers are a wonderful thing, but what we need to do is we need to have Christians in charge of these things. I mean, where are the Christians? Why are the Christians not involved in the political arena? Where are they?
That's right. That only exists.
Excuse me?
I live in Chicago.
Okay.
I live in Chicago. I'm living in the city of Chicago. We have 10 churches on one block. They don't even know each other. So we can't even vote in an alderman, much less a mayor, a governor, or a president. As Christians, we talk, but we don't get to the point where we say, okay, this is the problem. Now we need to develop a strategy for a solution.
So why don't these 10 churches know each other?
Because of the discipleship issue. Everybody wants their own empire. Everybody wants to lead their own church. We don't have a structure in place in our churches to develop people who are gifted to be sent out. So people are just doing things on their own. The young lady was talking about fraternities. A friend of mine, he's Omega Psi Phi. They had to go through a process. You just don't put on paraphernalia and jump around the party. You go through a process. You learn the history of the organization. You learn all of the rules and all of the stuff that they do to become, and then they have a ceremony to celebrate you coming out. Most churches, you can sit in there for 20 years. You won't become anything because the structure to develop you doesn't exist. We know they should be discipled, but when you start looking at the structures in our churches, in the average church, discipleship does not exist. We don't even know the people that are in our church. We pass them off, we have a few prayers and a few meetings, and they go home, and then the Democrats come, and they they win the president, the government, and the mayor of our cities, and then we say government don't matter, and then we got to go down to Springfield because they're voting for same-sex marriage. It does matter, and we need all of the Christians who claim to be Christ to look at your church and say, am I being discipled, or am I just in a gathering eating cupcakes on Sunday?
That's right.
Well, that's right. But it sounds to me like the problem is the pastors.
Hold on now. We're at...
There is.
Sounds to me the problem is the pastors.
There is.
We're almost at 9:30. How many of you all want to go for another 5 minutes? I got to ask them, though, because they're up there on the stage. I know you're getting tired, right?
Hey, we preaching, baby.
That's the congregation, though.
Go ahead, Dean.
I don't disagree. I don't disagree with much of what has been said, particularly with what Ben was saying as it relates to, you know, having Christians involved in government and things like that. But I think that it's important to have listened to what, you know, Kay James said a little bit earlier, because we can have Christians that are in government. We do need to engage society. But what I like to look at is what Jesus teaches, this principle of being faithful with little. And my question is, what are pastors, leaders, Christians doing in their own families? There's a biblical principle of what are you doing in your family, and then we can talk about you being a leader in the church. But if you're not faithful in demonstrating godly character and commitment with the children that God has given you, then you shouldn't even be thinking about, you know, looking to be involved in government, societal government, or church government. I think that there's a responsibility for us to look at first what is our responsibility in our microcosm, in our families. And I think that if we encourage, teach, and train people within our congregations and within our communities how to be better parents. I mean, we're dealing with, 70% or more of broken homes, right? We've got children that don't have fathers. Right. And what is our responsibility? I mean, one of the examples that Ben was using earlier about where religion is used in a positive context is in James of what? That's pure religion is to what? Take care of the, you know, the orphan and the widow. So we've got a responsibility to do that. In my mind, that's something that we have control of right now, regardless of whether who's in government, who's in charge. We need to stop some of the things that are happening at that level. But we've got a whole lot that we can do right now in our own families that we're not really, really being responsible for.
Be sure you could probably define widows and orphans. Make sure that's properly defined.
You want to define it for us?
I mean, you know what a widow is.
Yeah.
A widow is somebody whose husband has died.
Correct.
Okay. Orphans are those who lack parents.
That's right.
We're not talking about single moms. What is it, 76%?
Mm-hmm.
That's not what we're talking about. That's not who the church is supposed to be taking care of. There's also another biblical principle.
That's
very
right.
Simple principle.
Is it? I mean, which
it says, if a man don't work,
yeah, and that's something that's really good, Eric, because it's not just, you know, we talk about, it's not the government's role. Well, really, the church is even third in line. It's first the individual, then the family, then the church in terms of taking care of some of these different things. I mean, if we're pastors, if there's a guy that's in my congregation that's not taking care of his, I'm not paying his bill every month. I'm going to tell him, you need to go and get a church. I'll help to train you. I'll walk with you down there to get the job. But the church is not even supposed to be taking the responsibility if there's a man or a capable individual that's there to do that job. So I think that it's, again, going back to teaching from a biblical worldview, whose responsibility is it to do which particular thing?
Jerry Lawrence here. One of the things is, okay, Pastor Jerry Lawrence. one of the things is, we have to be deliberate as the body of Christ. And what many of you have said today is that it's our responsibility to make disciples. It's our responsibility to replicate ourselves. One of the biggest things that we see in the church community is that people want a superstar pastor rather than recognizing that they are called to be a disciple and to be a disciple maker as well. One of the things I think that happens with us is that we allow the people to push us to be the superstar pastor as opposed to teaching them that, no, I'm just here to equip you to do the work of the ministry. What do you think about that statement?
Well, if you go back and look at what Jesus did, Jesus is our example. And he had exactly that problem. Because when the time came for him to go, he called all his disciples together. And he did something that I guarantee you none of us have ever done. He called his disciples together, and then he took a basin, filled it up with water, wrapped a towel around himself. And then he went around washing their feet.
That's right.
And here's the significance of that. When he washed their feet, they had to wipe their feet on him. That's how they got their feet dry, wiping them on the Savior. And when he came to Peter, and Peter said, oh, no way, man, you're the superstar. I'm not wiping my feet on you. He said, if you don't wipe your feet on me, you have no part in me. That's the difference between him and a lot of us, because, you know, I never got a big kick out of letting people wipe their feet on me. I'm working on that. I'm working. But that is our example for how we, as ministers, servants of the gospel, should be operating. And if they try to make us into a superstar, that's kind of hard to resist, ain't it? So we
got to pray.
Yes, sir.
Got
to pray hard.
I think the other part about to add on to what Ben is saying, and please do not misunderstand me, because I am simply a sinner saved by grace.
Amen.
Okay. If you really want to know how gracious that is, you can ask my wife. Okay. But my point is this: the more we grow in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit and operate in the Spirit and teach through the anointing of the Spirit, the more my six members will come to understand who God is. And the less likely they will be to want to encourage me to operate in the flesh with the mega church. Not that the mega church is bad, but that they won't want me to be to think like that, because they won't think like that, because they are growing in the Spirit. And they will be so saturated and satisfied with a true relationship with God, that'll be the furthest thing from their mind. As a matter of fact, as soon as the enemy brings that to their mind, they will begin to rebuke the devil themselves. Why? Because now they understand what this thing called Christianity is. It's not about me and my four. It's about me and my God. And that is the missing link in the church in general. We are so earthly minded that we have become so spiritually useless. A friend of mine told me about a gentleman that came over to America to visit the churches. And he visited and he visited and he went back to his homeland. And they asked him, how say you about the churches in America? And his answer was, it is amazing what they can do without God.
All right.
This is where we are, my friends.
We have one more question. I'm sorry. We're going to have to cut it off at some point. We could go all night. And I'm enjoying this. I really am. I hope you are, too. You getting something out of this? So here's the last question, because I know we got to get up early. Ben Kinchlow is the first speaker tomorrow.
And he's talking about Democrats. Beer.
Black, yellow dogs is black, what he's going to talk about. Dog.
I wanted to bring our attention to the First Amendment, and I think that we've been tricked into a misunderstanding of the First Amendment, which says that Congress shall make no law prohibiting the free expression of religion. What that means to me, atheism is a religion. So right now atheism is being pushed on all of us, or this, the humanism, or whatever that people want to call it. And I would say that we who are spiritually minded, who are church minded, and I'm not from the Christian faith, I'm actually Hebrew, but I think all faiths have a role to play in this, and I'm a conservative for sure, is that what that means to me is that every religion should be expressing their faith in schools and everywhere else in public places, that it should be a situation where every religion is honored and valued. That's how values get taught. They get taught, to me, in the through religious experiences. And so when you bar religious experiences from public places like schools, and you have children who spend all their time in school, 8-hour school days, and they're not at home, and you have parents who are working and everybody's working, when do the values get taught? And people don't go to church hardly so much anymore, the six people. So except for six people. So we've got to start teaching the values so that if the Muslims want to pray at 5 o'clock on such and such, they stop and let them go someplace and pray. If the Christians want to do their holidays, stop and let them do their holidays. And I think we have to start, we have to demand that the First Amendment actually says that Congress shall not prohibit the free expression of religion. And we need to act on that, because I'm thinking that we have these women who are getting these 20 million abortions. These women are church women. Okay, so what and how has the church missed teaching them that they're murdering their children? We have these men who started out in church as children because their mamas brought them to church. How did we lose them? I think we have to, you know, the church has to do a better job of connecting with Yeah, that was the question. That was the question.
Yeah, that was the question. I got it too.
But here again is our issue. That it becomes that issue of trying to teach your membership that destroying your baby in the womb for sport, 20 million children, it becomes a partisan issue. And the church has allowed for herself, especially in our context, has allowed for herself to be determined to be dictated by what Democrats should do. And again, you know, I gotta say, and I don't want to come across as too militant to anyone. The reality is that I just like to tell the truth. And the truth of the matter is that there's a separation of church and state. It doesn't say there's a separation of religion and state. It doesn't say that there's a separation of the mosque and state or the temple and state. It's the church and state. Because those who were fleeing from persecution as Freemasons in this country did not want the powerful influence of the church on what they were doing. We need to look at the truths of the history of our country and realize that everyone who will, the persons who will be hated and will be berated and will be chided within this country within the next few years will be the Christians. And it will not be the Muslims per se. It will not be the Taoist or the Hindu. It's going to be the Christians. The Christians are the ones who are coming under an attack and have been for many, many decades. And it's intensifying day after day. And there's no one to defend the Christians. We can't pray in schools because we were totally an absent parent as it relates to that issue. Right now, the children can't talk about their faith, but if they were born a boy and thinking about becoming a girl, and then after I'm a girl for a little while, I want to become a boy again, well, now they are the popular ones in the classroom. But you are lame and you are a loser if you're a believer, and everyone is going to allow for the Christians to come under that attack, and after a while, they're coming for all the other faiths, but it's going to start with the church. And we have to unify, not under the banners that we have in the past. We have to unify under a bloodstained banner. We have to unify as it relates to morality and what is right. And we have to unify even as a people, because the murder is being committed of our own people. And the church has a responsibility to say to the rest of our community, enough is enough. We need to come out of these churches and we need to stop the murder of our children and do something about what's going on.
Let me hold on. We're gonna have to end this at some point.
Wait, before you do that,
that's right. Before you end this, so that's two.
Couple of seconds.
Before you end this,
we'll go down the row. We'll go down the row. Okay.
Go down the row.
One last statement.
All right.
Don't leave it alone.
The scripture, he had shown thee, O man, what is good and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Micah 6:8.
Yes, sir.
And I do believe that if we were to reinforce those words in our homes and prepare our children, that the confusion that would be inflicted upon them by the state or by any other outside factor would be minimized. We've got to be more vigilant and not reactionary. We have to make the connection to our communities. Our churches must escape the four walls and become a vital and ever encroaching presence in our communities, one on one. And in this pressing day, and I'm bringing it to a close, that as Ceasar, I don't mean you. As Caesar asks for more and more, we're going to have to distinguish what to give him, but do our thing as Christians.
Now, as you go try and relate some of this to the family as well.
Brother, you mentioned, you mentioned separation of church and state. Where do you get that from?
Church and state?
The separation of church and state. Where do you get that from?
Out of our Constitution.
Where?
That's an interpretation.
Where?
It's a misconception.
That's very true.
It is a misconception.
Exactly.
A misconception.
All right. Can we? Okay. We're supposed to be closing.
I know. We're closing.
If you want to talk about that.
No.
This is
critical, in my opinion.
Okay.
This is critical.
Go ahead.
What you're saying, ma'am, would you read that First Amendment again? Just the First Amendment. Read the whole thing. Not the whole thing. I'll tell you when to stop. But the First Amendment. Read it like it's written.
Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free expression thereof.
All right, now see what happens is you hear a whole lot about the separation clause, you know, the establishment clause. Well, you people can't pray because you violated the establishment clause. But if you heard that correctly, it says Congress. Not the local school boards, not the local citizens. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment, that means the Church of England or the Catholic Church in Italy, of religion. But then it immediately says, or prohibit the free exercise thereof. So the minute somebody tells you you can't pray under the establishment clause, they have violated your right to do so under the free exercise clause. Don't fall for that. That's a crime.
That's right.
Next.
I'm sorry, I got my name, but that just
passionate about that one, aren't you, Ben?
It is indeed a misconception. I guess my final remarks would be that we need to really go back to the Word of God to understand who we are as a body of believers, and we need to study that ourselves. Those of us that are charged with teaching and preaching and pastoring, our charge is to teach so that people understand what it really means to be born again. Exactly. Until we do that, we're going to continue to have the voids in our community, in our churches, and our people are going to continue to suffer because this is indeed a spiritual battle. All of the other things we fight, it is indeed a spiritual battle, and unless our people are taught, our people mean especially the people of America, unless we are taught biblical truths through the anointing of the Spirit of God, we will continue to suffer and perish.
Dean?
In closing, I don't remember the last stat from Barna, but it demonstrated that roughly, I thought it's certainly under 15% of Americans, not just black Americans, don't have a biblical worldview, 9%. So I think that we as the church have to recapture, one, what our purpose is, particularly in the teaching and the training and the discipleship of the next generation, or else, you know, we will, as Dr. King said, become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority.
I appreciate everything that these pastors have said up here, and I agree with most of them. And in closing, I just say that it's church and state. I'm not much interested in getting the church into the state or the state in the church. I'm interested in getting people into the kingdom of God. I'm interested in advancing the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the answer for the world. That's the solution. That's the answer, is Jesus Christ. Everything else follows after that. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else would be added after that. Unless we focus people back to the lordship of Jesus Christ, and unless we teach the kingdom principles as they are outlined in the Bible, all of our philosophies and all of our other thoughts are useless. That's the answer, the kingdom of God.
I agree with all that was said, and most of you know that I am an author, written 26 books. And most of my emphasis has been in political science, sociology, and theology. But some words that Jesus really pricked my heart in the last couple years. When the children came to Jesus, the disciples held them back. And Jesus said, suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not. And the Lord says, Jesus realized that if he didn't influence those kids, somebody else would. Children come in the world imitating, duplicating, and emulating behavior. The behavior they're most likely to duplicate is the behavior they're most often exposed to. And if we do not concentrate on the children as much as we do the taipayers in the church, we're going to catch the children after they have been indoctrinated by the schools, indoctrinated by TV, music, movies, and then we're going to try to convert them when we could have did like Jesus and said, suffer the little children to come unto me. Let me take the time to indoctrinate them the way I want them indoctrinated, and I don't have to worry about converting them a little bit later on. So I think my last two books have written just for young people, teens and young people who have impacted the world. And my other book, Political, Whites, Blacks, and Racist Democrats, The History of Racism in Politics. And I wrote these for the children. My teenage book is in 80 school districts throughout the country. Now, I realize God gives us all different things. Just because I write books don't mean I'm more important than what God has given you to do. But we do need to reach the children. Suffer the little children to come unto us, and let us be the one that influenced them.
I want to end with a quote. Since we were celebrating the 50-year march, it's not the whole quote. I wish I had the whole thing with Dr. King. He says, there was a time when the church was very powerful, and it was during a period when the early Christians rejoiced at being deemed worthy to suffer for what they believed. In those days, the church was not merely a thermostat that recorded the ideas of popular opinion. It wasn't a thermometer that recorded the ideas of popular opinion. It was the thermostat that transformed the mores of society. I would say with abortion at 36% of the black community, with 73% out of wedlock births, with over 95% voting for people who don't share our values, says that the church has a problem. But the church is not helpless. As long as we fall on our knees and repent and call on God's Spirit to renew our spirit, as long as we call on God to touch our lives and to help us preach the word day in and day out, as we're examples, as we become disciplers, I'm with you. I didn't get a PhD because I wanted to spend all that time in school and a lot of money. I got it because I wanted to teach other people. It's important to get training. It is.